Hi, you're watching New York State Legislative Report with Senator Liz Krueger. I'm Julia Lokenzie, and I'll be your host as your state senator and I discuss what's going on in New York State and the New York State Senate. How are you?
Morning.
You chair the Senate Committee on Budget and Tax Reform, and you're really opening up the process. Why don't you tell us about these hearings you're having?
Great. Well, last week I held a hearing in Rochester, New York. And on May 21st, I'm holding another one in New York City around the topic of corporate and franchise taxes. And of course, tax policy is a huge issue that most of the public knows very little about, and I want to get them more involved because the issue of tax policy is who pays for government services, and then how much money do we have to actually make decisions about providing government services. So it all starts with where we get our revenue. And I fundamentally believe that in the 21st century, New York State needs to reevaluate our tax policy decisions. You know, some of our taxes were in our tax code were written in the 1920s when New York State was still a totally agrarian state. So some of the policies involving property tax, business tax, individual tax, all should have serious questions asked in the 21st century. And so again, this hearing and the next hearing are about corporate taxes and questions such as who's paying them, are they fair, what impacts are they having on business, are there competitive disadvantages in different parts of the state or between New York and other states, and I suppose most complicated for us all, we're now in a global economy. So today, we're not just talking about businesses competing town to town or state to state. We're talking about, do our tax policies and economic development policies impact whether businesses in America are successful versus businesses around the world?
Right. And we are in economic instability right now. You spoke about that in Rochester, and I'd like to show a video clip. You talked about how sometimes things worked then, they may not work now.
That's right.
Let's take a look at that.
To better understand, again, what has been working, what has not been working, and how the state can move forward with potential changes to our corporate franchise tax policies to be a win-win for the state of New York, to do exactly what they are intended to do, support economic development and support business growth in the state of New York and job growth in the state of New York, to ensure that the policies we have are fair and equitable so that we do not have one group of businesses coming forward and saying, these taxes are great, and another group of businesses coming forward and say, you completely disadvantaged me from a competitive perspective with my my quote-unquote competitors in the state of New York, to avoid what I would call range wars between towns and counties, fighting to claim the jobs where we are simply moving the jobs like deck chairs on the Titanic, as opposed to actually meeting our assignment, create new jobs and new business activity for New York State. And of course, because the fundamental purpose of tax policy is to ensure that our states and localities have adequate revenues to meet their obligations for public service, that we also don't find ourselves in a situation where good tax policy translates to nothing to operate government, because I would also put on the table for you that when I speak to businesses in my part of New York, which is New York City, one of the first things they will tell me is, yes, tax policy is important for economic development, but if I can't hire an educated workforce, I have no opportunities for my company. If I can't get my people, my workers and my clients to and from where I'm doing business, I can't be located in this area. And finally, as one constituent businessman recently explained to me, if nobody else is earning enough in the economy to buy what I'm selling, then I can't sell. So it's also tied into ensuring that we have a well-rounded and diverse economy.
Yeah, it's smart to think or rethink tax policy and economic development.
Well, particularly because New York State has had a fairly broad arsenal of programs on its books that we call economic development, and disproportionately those involve giving tax credits and expenditures and what some people call tax loopholes. Well, my question is, if we're going to not collect taxes from certain businesses, we better make sure that, in fact, from an economic development perspective, it's working. So some people talk about evaluating economic development models based on how many jobs did you create, how much new businesses did you actually develop. And I think that's exactly the questions we should apply to tax policy. If you and I have the same type of business, and you're located in one town and I'm located in another town, and we're competitors, should the state of New York give you an advantage over me in tax policy? What's the justification? We should have to ask and answer that question. If the state of New York is deciding that it's giving incentives to change business practice, such as supporting green manufacturing as opposed to polluting manufacturing, I think that's a completely legitimate question to ask. Can we incentivize good public policy by businesses? But then we have on our tax code from years and years ago tax incentives for petroleum-driven product production. We all know we're trying to decrease the use of petroleum products. That is not new news for anyone watching us today. We want to be less dependent on foreign oil. We know about the pollution impacts of petroleum products. So I'm a little confused why we still have on the books all these tax incentives for the use of petroleum products. I would be much more interested in looking at how we support the greening of our economy, the greening of our manufacturing base, because that is not only a win for our businesses for international competitiveness, but that's a win for our environment.
Absolutely. You got to bring it back to today and what's going on with
exactly.
Today. When it comes to reforming tax measures relating to economic opportunity, new changes are going to come to the state's tax incentive program that entices businesses to set up shop within a certain area, the Empire Zone. Why don't you tell us about that?
Well, in fact, there's been a lot of discussion about Empire Zones for years in Albany. There was some changes made in the law going forward about 5 years ago, but many of us felt not enough. And so in the budget deal that we just completed for this year, we actually sunset the Empire Zone law in 2010, a year earlier than originally planned. So now it really puts the onus on the state legislature and the governor to take a look at what worked and didn't work in the Empire Zones, and I believe come up with a much better program. I've not been a big fan of Empire Zones, and I don't think the evidence is out there to justify now up to $700 million in lost tax revenue per year. I'm not saying the state of New York shouldn't be investing $700 million in economic development, but I want models that I know and I can justify to all 19 million New Yorkers are the right way to do economic development and support businesses. So I really think our work is cut out for us to come up with a better model than we have had on using the tax code for economic development. And I'm actually been working with a number of people around a different set of programs and looking at what's working in other states, because that's always a great model. Let's see what's working somewhere else and see whether it would work here in New York. And what I was really pleased about from the Rochester hearing was how many business people and business associations were saying to me, you know, that's right, we're not in love with the Empire Zones. We see all kinds of flaws with them, but we are concerned that we need a model that, in fact, addresses the needs of our communities. So I think this is a great opportunity to come up with a better program by June 2010. And so I'm planning on spending quite a bit of the time of my committee working on exactly that.
So what will happen to the businesses that participate in the program right now?
Well, if you're a business who's already in the program, you have a commitment of a 10 or 15 year timeline for your program. So even if the law expires, when the law expires, it doesn't mean that if you have still 3 to 5 years left on your commitment from the state that that shuts down. As long as you have been a player in good faith in the program, you will continue to get the benefits that were committed to you when you joined. But it will mean going forward, New York State may not have the same package of tax incentives available, because again, I believe that we can come up with a better model that gets better results.
Great. What are some other corporate franchise tax expenditures that you're taking a look at?
Okay. Well, again, the Empire Zone is a big one, but really the franchise tax is a formula of a tax paid by different kinds of businesses and different amounts, and sometimes large companies have a greater incentive built in than smaller companies. So I'm really exploring what are the franchise taxes that we should perhaps reevaluate the definition of who's eligible. I heard quite a bit from manufacturing companies in upstate New York when I held my Rochester hearing, and they were talking about proposals for tax incentives specifically around the manufacturing sector. They talked specifically about energy costs being a huge issue for them in manufacturing, because in fact of all businesses, manufacturers are disproportionately heavy users of energy. So they were talking about the tie-in of our energy policy and our energy tax incentives and our corporate franchise tax. We heard from some people talking about sort of newer industries versus more traditional types of industries as far as biotech and research and how tax policy might apply to them. I know I expect that when I have the second hearing down in New York City, I will hear less about manufacturing because we don't manufacture very much in New York City, and I'll hear more about some of the corporate and back office models of franchise taxes.
For the people who can't make it to these hearings, is there a way that they could read up on the reports or watch it?
Well, actually, I'm very excited about the fact that I think by next week we will be announcing a website for my Select Committee on Tax and Budget Policy, and all of the testimony submitted at any hearing will be up on the internet, and actual recordings of the hearings will be available to be streamed on the website. And in fact, my staff are working on a summary report of each hearing we do, or each topic we do. So we already have available our summary report on our personal income tax hearing. Actually, I've gotten very positive feedback, and people can call my office if they want a hard copy, or it'll be up on the website within a week. Then the two franchise tax hearings will be combined into a report. We're just going to keep going from there. There's so many different sub-issues in tax policy. Also, the relationship between federal proposals for changing taxes, state changes to taxes. There's the whole world of, can you maximize smart tax policy by having parallel rules with the federal government, or in some cases deciding the federal policy is not really in your best interest and trying to balance off against that.
So that web address that you were talking about, is that will that be linked up to LizKrueger.com?
You'll be able to find it on LizKrueger.com. You'll also be able to find it through the Senate website. And I'm sorry, I don't have the website name yet. But since, of course, we're taping this and you'll be able to even see our show on my website, I would guess we'll be able to figure out how to insert that website for people who are watching the show today.
Great. And LizKrueger.com is very easy to remember.
Exactly.
So the New York City hearing, that's on May 21st.
May 21st. And again, anyone is welcome to submit testimony. Anyone is welcome to come to the hearing. Depending on how many people sign up, we may not be able to allow every person to testify. I know we've got a very good response already for New York City, so I'm certainly not discouraging anyone who has something to say to come and testify. You know, it's funny, I'm trying to make tax policy sexy. Because people think tax is so dry, they're not. They're critical for our future.
Yeah, you have made it easy to understand, and I think that's key.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for being with us, Senator. For any additional information, LizKrueger.com.